A Thanksgiving Sermon by Robert Greene Ingersoll. Many ages ago, our fathers were living in dens and caves. Their bodies, their low foreheads, were covered with hair. They were eating berries, roots, bark, and vermin. They were fond of snakes and raw fish. They discovered fire, and probably by accident, learned how to cause it by friction. They fashioned clubs and made rude weapons of stone, with which they killed the larger beast, and now and then, each other. Slowly, painfully, almost imperceptibly, they advanced. They crawled and stumbled, staggered and struggled toward the light. To them the world was unknown. On every hand was the mysterious, the sinister, the hurtful. The forest were filled with monsters, and the darkness was crowded with ghosts, devils, and fiendish gods. These poor wretches were the slaves of fear, the sport of dreams. Now and then one rose a little above his fellows, used his senses, the little reason that he had, found something new, some better way. Then the people killed him and afterward knelt with reverence at his grave. Then another thinker gave his thought, was murdered, another tomb became sacred, another step was taken in advance. And so through countless years of ignorance and cruelty, of thought and crime, of murder and worship, of heroism, suffering, and self-denial, the race has reached the heights where now we stand. Looking back over the long, devious roads that lie between the barbarism of the past and the civilization of today, thinking of the centuries that rolled was like waves between distant shores, we can form some idea of what our fathers suffered, of the mistakes they made, some idea of the ignorance, their stupidity, some idea of their sense, their goodness, their heroism. It is a long road from the savage to the scientist, from a den to a mansion, from leaves to clothes, from a flickering rush to the arc light, from a hammer of stone to the modern mill, a long distance from the pipe of Pan to the violin to the orchestra, from a floating log to a steamship, from a sickle to a reaper, from a flail to a threshing machine, from a crook stick to a plow, from a spinning wheel to a spinning jenny, from a hand loom to a jacquard that weaves fair forms of wondrous flowers beyond Arachne's utmost dream, from a few hieroglyphics on the skin of beast, on bricks of clay, to a printing press, to a library, a long distance from the messenger traveling on foot to the electric spark, from the knives and tools of stone to those of steel, a long distance from sand to telescopes, from echo to the phonograph that buries in indented lines and dots the sounds of living speech, and then gives back to life the very words and voices of the dead, a long way from the trumpet to the telephone that transports speech as swift as thought and drops the words perfect as minted coins in the listening ears, a long way from a fallen tree to the suspension bridge, from the dried sinews of beasts to the cables of steel, from the oar to the propeller, from the sling to the rifle, from the catapult to the cannon, a long distance from revenge to law, from the club to the legislature, from slavery to freedom, from appearance to fact, from fear to reason. And yet the distance has been traveled by the human race. Countless obstructions have been overcome, numberless enemies have been conquered, thousands and thousands of victories have been won for the right, and millions have lived, labored, and died for their fellow men. For the blessings we enjoy, for the happiness that is ours, we ought to be grateful. Our hearts should blossom with thankfulness. Whom, what should we thank? Let us be honest, generous. Should we thank the church? Christianity has controlled Christendom for at least 1,500 years. During these centuries, what have the Orthodox churches accomplished for the good of man? In this life, man needs raiment and roof, food and fuel. He must be protected from heat and cold, from snow and storm. He must take thought for the morrow. In the summer of youth, he must prepare for the winter of age. He must know something of the cause of disease, of the conditions of health. If possible, he must conquer pain, increase happiness, and lengthen life. He must supply the wants of the body and feed the hunger of the mind. What good has the church done? Has it taught men to cultivate the earth, to build homes, to weave cloth, to cure or prevent disease, to build ships, to navigate the seas, to conquer pain, or to lengthen life? Did Christ or any of his apostles add to the sum of useful knowledge? Did they say one word in favor of science, of any art? Did they teach their fellow man how to make a living, how to overcome the obstructions of nature, how to prevent sickness, how to protect themselves from pain, from famine, from misery and rags? Did they explain any of the phenomena of nature, any of the facts that affect the life of man? Did they say anything in favor of investigation, of study, of thought? Did they teach the gospel of self-reliance, of industry, of honest effort? Can any farmer, mechanic, or scientist find in the New Testament one useful fact? Is there anything in the sacred book that can help the geologist, the astronomer, the biologist, the physician, the inventor, the manufacturer of any useful thing? What has the church done? From the very first, it taught the vanity, the worthlessness of all earthly things. It taught the wickedness of wealth, the blessedness of poverty. It taught that the business of life was to prepare for death. It insisted that a certain belief was necessary to ensure salvation, and that all who failed to believe or doubted in the least would suffer eternal pain. According to the church, the natural desires, ambition, and passions of man were all wicked and depraved. To love God, to practice self-denial, to overcome desire, to despise wealth, to hate prosperity, to desert wife and children, to live on the roots and berries, to repeat prayers, to wear rags, to live in filth, and drive love from the heart, these for centuries were the highest and most perfect virtues, and those who practiced them were saints. The saints did not assist their fellow men. Their fellow men assisted them. They did not labor for others. They were beggars, parasites, vermin. They were insane. They followed the teachings of Christ. They took no thought for the morrow. They mutilated their bodies, scarred their flesh, and destroyed their minds in the sake of happiness in another world. During the journey of life, they kept their eyes on the grave. They gathered no flowers by the way. They walked in the dust of the road, avoided the green fields. Their moans made all the music they wished to hear. The babble of brooks, the songs of birds, the laughter of children were nothing to them. Pleasure was the child of sin, and the happy needed a change of heart. They were sinless and miserable, but they had faith. They were pious and wretched, but they were limping towards heaven. What has the church done? It has denounced pride and luxury, all things that adorn and enrich life, all pleasures of sense, the ecstasies of love and happiness of the hearth, the clasp and kiss of wife and child. And the church has done this because it regarded this life as a period of probation, a time to prepare, to become spiritual, to overcome the natural, to fix the affections on the invisible, to become passionless, to subdue the flesh, to congeal the blood, to fold the wings of fancy, to become dead to the world, so that when you appeared before God, you would be the exact opposite of what He made you. What has the church done? It pretended to have a revelation from God. It knew the road to eternal joy, the way to death. It preached salvation by faith and declared that only Orthodox believers could become angels and that all doubters would be damned. It knew this, and so knowing, it became the enemy of discussion, of investigation, of thought. Why investigate? Why discuss? Why think when you know? It sought to enslave the world. It appealed to force. It unsheathed the sword, lighted the faggot, forged the chain, built the dungeon, erected the scaffold, invented and used the instruments of torture. It branded, maimed, and mutilated. It imprisoned and tortured. It blinded and burned, hanged and crucified, and utterly destroyed millions and millions of human beings. It touched every nerve of the body, produced every pain that can be felt, every agony that can be endured. And it did this to preserve what it called the truth, to destroy heresy and doubt, and to save, if possible, the souls of a few. It was honest. It was necessary to prevent the development of the brain, to arrest all progress. And to do this, the church used all its power. If men were allowed to think and express their thoughts, they would fill their minds and the minds of others with doubts. If they were allowed to think, they would investigate, and then they might contradict the creed, dispute the words of the priest, and defy the church. The priest cried to the people, "It is for us to talk. It is for you to hear. Our duty is to preach, and yours is to believe." What has the church done? There have been thousands of councils and synods, thousands and thousands of occasions where the clergy have met and discussed and quarreled, when pope and cardinals, bishops and priests had added to or explained their creeds and denied rights of others. What use or truth did they discover? What fact did they find? Did they add to the intellectual wealth of the world? Did they increase the sum of knowledge? I admit they looked over a number of Jewish books and picked out the ones that Jehovah wrote. Did they find the medical virtue that dwells in any weed or flower? I know that they decided that the Holy Ghost was not created, not begotten, but that He proceeded. Did they teach us the mysteries of the metals and how to purify the ores in furnace flames? They shouted, "Great is the mystery of godliness." Did they show us how to improve our condition in this world? They informed us that Christ had two natures and two wills. Did they give us even a hint as to any useful thing? They gave us predestination, foreordination, and just enough free will. Did they discover or show us how to produce anything for food? Did they produce anything to satisfy the hunger of man? Instead of this, they discovered that the peasant girl who lived in Palestine was the mother of God. They proved it by a book, and to make the book evidenced, they called it inspired. Did they tell us anything about chemistry, how to combine and separate substances, how to subtract the hurtful, how to produce the useful? They told us that bread, by making certain motions and mumbling certain prayers, could be changed into the flesh of God, and that in the same way, wine could be changed into his blood. And this, notwithstanding the fact that God never had any flesh or blood, but has always been spirit without body, parts, or passions. What has the church done? It gave us the history of the world, of the stars, and the beginning of all things. It taught the geology of Moses, the astronomy of Joshua and Elijah. It taught the fall of man and the atonement, proved that a Jewish peasant was God, established the existence of hell, purgatory, and heaven. It pretended to have a revelation from God, the scriptures, in which can be found all knowledge, everything that man could need in the journey of life. Nothing outside the inspired book, except legends and prayers, could be of any value. Books that contradict the Bible were hurtful. Those that agreed with it, useless. Nothing was of importance except faith, credulity, belief. The church said, "Let philosophy alone count your beads. Ask no questions. Fall upon your knees, shut your eyes, and save your souls." What has the church done? For centuries it kept the earth flat. For centuries it made all the host of heaven travel around this world. For centuries it clung to sacred knowledge. It fought facts with the ferocity of a fiend. For centuries it hated the useful. It was the deadly enemy of medicine. Disease was produced by devils and could be cured only by priests, decaying bones, and holy water. Doctors were the rivals of priests. They diverted their revenues. The church opposed the study of anatomy, was against the dissection of the dead. Man had no right to cure disease. God would do that through his priest. Man had no right to prevent disease. Man had no right to prevent disease. Diseases were sent by God as judgments. The church opposed inoculation, vaccination, and the use of chloroform and ether. It was declared to be a sin, a crime for a woman to lessen the pangs of motherhood. The church declared that woman must bear the curse of the merciful Jehovah. What has the church done? It taught that the insane were inhabited by devils. Insanity was not a disease. It was produced by demons. It could be cured by prayers, gifts, amulets, and charms. All these had to be paid for. This enriched the church. These ideas were honestly entertained by Protestants as well as Catholics, by Luther, Calvin, Knox, and Wesley. What has the church done? It taught the awful doctrine of witchcraft. It filled the darkness with demons, the air with devils, and the world with grief and shame. It charged men, women, and children with being in league with Satan to injure their fellows. Old women were convicted for causing storms at sea, for preventing rain, and for bringing frost. Girls were convicted for having changed themselves into wolves, snakes, and toads. These witches were burned for causing diseases, for selling their souls, for souring beer. All these things were done with the aid of the devil, who sought to persecute the faithful, the lambs of God. Satan sought in many ways to scandalize the church. He sometimes assumed the appearance of a priest and committed crimes. On one occasion, he personated a bishop renowned for his sanctity, allowed himself to be discovered and dragged from the room of the beautiful widow. So perfectly did he counterfeit the features and form of the bishop that many who were well acquainted with the prelate were actually deceived, and the widow herself thought her lover was the bishop. All this was done by the devil to bring reproach upon holy men. Hundreds of like instances could be given, as the war waged between demons and priests was long and bitter. These popes and priests, these clergymen, were not hypocrites. They believed in the New Testament, the teachings of Christ, and they knew the principal business of the Savior was casting out devils. What has the church done? It made the wife a slave, the property of the husband. It placed the husband as much above the wife as Christ was above the husband. It taught that the nun was purer, nobler than the mother. It induced millions of pure and conscientious girls to renounce joys of life, to take the veil woven of night and death, to wear the habiliments of the dead, made them believe that they were brides of Christ. For my part, I would as soon be a widow of the bride of a man who had been dead for 1,800 years. The poor deluded girls imagined that they, in some mysterious way, were in spiritual wedlock, united with God. All worldly desires were driven from their hearts. They filled their lives with fastings, with prayers, with self-accusings. They forgot their fathers and mothers and gave their love. They were the victims, the convicts of superstition, prisoners in the penitentiaries of God, conscientious, good, sincere, insane. These loving women gave their hearts to a phantom, their lives to a dream. A few years ago, at a revival, a fine, buxom girl was converted, born again. In her excitement, she cried, "I'm married to Christ. I'm married to Christ." In her delirium, she threw her arms around the neck of an old man and again cried, "I'm married to Christ." The old man, who happened to be a kind of skeptic, gently removed her hand, saying at the same time, "I don't know much about your husband, but I have great respect for your father-in-law." Priests, theologians have taken advantage of women, of their gentleness, their love of approbation. They have lived upon their hopes and fears. Like vampires, they have sucked their blood. They have made them responsible for the sins of the world. They have taught them the slave virtues, meekness, humility, implicit obedience. They have fed their minds with mistakes, mysteries, and absurdities. They have endeavored to weaken and shrivel their brains until, to them, there would be no possible connection between evidence and belief, between fact and faith. What has the church done? It was the enemy of commerce, of business. It denounced the taking of interest for money. Without taking interest for money, progress is impossible. The steamships, the great factories, the railroads have all been built with borrowed money, money on which interest was promised and, for the most part, paid. The church was opposed to fire insurance, to life insurance. It denounced insurance in any form as gambling, as immoral. To insure your life was to declare that you had no confidence in God, that you relied on corporation instead of divine providence. It was declared that God would provide for your widow and your fatherless children. To insure your life was to insult heaven. What has the church done? The church regarded epidemics as the messengers of the good God. The Black Death was sent by the Eternal Father, whose mercy spared some and whose justice murdered the rest. To stop the scourge, they tried to soften the heart of God by kneeling and prostrations, by processions and prayers, by burning incense and by making vows. They did not try to remove the cause. The cause was God. They did not ask for pure water, but for holy water. Faith and filth lived, or rather died, together. Religion and rags, piety and pollution, kept company. Sanctity kept its odor. What has the church done? It was the enemy of art and literature. It destroyed the marbles of Greece and Rome. Beauty was pagan. It destroyed so far as it could the best literature of the world. It feared thought, but it preserved the scriptures. The ravings of insane saints, the falsehoods of the fathers, the bulls of popes, and the accounts of miracles performed by shrines, by dry blood and faded hair, by pieces of bones and wood, by rusty nails and thorns, by handkerchiefs and rags, by water and beads, and by a finger of the Holy Ghost. This was the literature of the church. I admit that the priests were honest, as honest as ignorant. More could not be said. What has the church done? Christianity claims with great pride that it established asylums for the insane. Yes, it did. But the insane were treated as criminals. They were regarded as the home, as the tenement houses of devils. They were persecuted and tormented. They were chained and flogged, starved and killed. The asylums were prisons, dungeons. The insane were victims, and the keepers were ignorant, conscientious, pious fiends. They were not trying to help men. They were fighting devils, destroying demons. They were not actuated by love, but by hate and fear. In founded schools where facts were denied, where science was denounced and philosophy despised, schools where priests were made, where they were taught to hate reason and to look upon doubts as the suggestions of devils, schools in which lies were sacred and truths profane, schools for the more general diffusion of ignorance, schools to prevent thought, to suppress knowledge, schools for the purpose of enslaving the world, schools in which teachers knew less than pupils. What has the church done? It has used its influence with God to get rain and sunshine, to stop floods and storms, to kill insects, rats, snakes, and wild beasts, to stay pestilence and famine, to delay frost and snow, to lengthen the lives of kings and queens, to protect presidents, to give legislatures wisdom, to increase collections and subscriptions. In marriages, it has made God the party of the third part. It has sprinkled water on the babes when they were named. It has put oil on the dying and repeated prayers for the dead. It has tried to protect the people from the malice of the devil, from the ghosts and spooks, from witches and wizards, and all the leering fiends that seek to poison the souls of men. It has endeavored to protect the sheep of God from the wolves of science, from the wild beast of doubt and investigation. and has tried to wean the lambs of the Lord from the delights, the pleasures, the joys of life. According to the philosophy of the church, the virtuous weep and suffer, the vicious laugh and thrive, the good carry a cross, the wicked fly. But in the next life, this will be reversed. Then the good will be happy, and the bad will be damned. The church filled the world with faith and crime. It polluted the fountains of joy. It gave us ignorant, jealous, revengeful, and cruel God, sometimes merciful, sometimes ferocious, now just, now infamous, sometimes wise, generally foolish. It gave us a devil, cunning, malicious, almost equal to God, not quite as strong, but quicker, not as profound, but sharper. It gave us angels with wings, cherubim and seraphim, and a heaven with harps and hallelujahs, with streets of gold and gates of pearl. It gave us fiends and imps with wings like bats. It gave us ghosts and goblins, spooks and sprites, and little devils that swarmed in the bodies of men. And it gave us hell, where the souls of men will roast in eternal flames. Shall we thank the church? Shall we thank the Orthodox churches? Shall we thank them for the hell they made here? Shall we thank them for the hell of the future? We must remember that the church was founded and has been protected by God, that all the popes and cardinals, all the bishops, priests, and monks, all the ministers and exhorters were selected and set apart, all sanctified and enlightened by the infinite God, that the Holy Scriptures were inspired by the same being, that all the Orthodox creeds were really made by him. We know what these men, filled with the Holy Ghost, have done. We know the part they have played. We know the souls they have saved and the bodies they have destroyed. We know the consolation they have given and the pain they have inflicted, the lies they have defended, the truths they have denied. We know that they have convinced millions that celibacy is the greatest of all virtues, that women are perpetual temptations and the enemies of true holiness, that monks and priests are nobler than fathers, that nuns are purer than mothers. We know that they taught the blessed absurdity of the Trinity, that God once worked at the trade of a carpenter in Palestine. We know that they divided knowledge into sacred and profane, taught that revelation was sacred, that reason was blasphemous, that faith was holy, in fact, false, that the sin of Adam and Eve brought disease and pain, vice and death into the world. We know that they have taught the dogma of special providence, that all events are ordained and regulated by God, that he crowns and uncrowns kings, preserves and destroys, guards and kills, that it's the duty of man to submit to the divine will, and that no matter how much evil there may be, no matter how much suffering, how much pain and death, man should pour out his heart in thankfulness that it is no worse. Let me be understood. I do not say, and I do not think, that the church was dishonest, that the clergy were insincere. I admit that all religions, all creeds, all priests have been naturally produced. I admit, and cheerfully admit, that the believers in the supernatural have done some good, not because they believed in gods and devils, but in spite of it. I know that thousands and thousands of clergymen are honest, self-denying, and humane, that they are doing what they believe to be their duty, doing what they can to induce men and women to live pure, noble lives. This is not the result of their creeds. It is because they are human. What I say is that every honest teacher of the supernatural has been and is an unconscious enemy of the human race. What is the philosophy of the church of those who believe in the supernatural? Back of all that is, back of all events, Christians put an infinite juggler who with a wish creates, preserves, and destroys. The world is his stage and mankind his puppets. He fills them with wants and desires, with appetites and ambitions, with hopes and fears, with love and hate. He touches the springs. He pulls the strings, baits the hooks, sets the traps, and digs the pits. The play is a continuous performance. He watches these puppets as they struggle and fail, sees them outwit each other and themselves, leads them to every crime, watches the births and deaths, hears lullabies at cradles and falls of clods in coffins. He has no pity. He enjoys the tragedies, the desperation, despair, the suicides. He smiles at the murders, the assassinations, the seductions, the desertions, the abandoned babes of shame. He sees the weak enslaved, mothers robbed of babes, the innocent in dungeons, on scaffolds. He sees crime crowned and hypocrisy robed. He withholds the rain and his puppets starve. He opens the earth, and they are devoured. He sends the flood, and they are drowned. He empties the volcano, and they perish in fire. He sends a cyclone, and they are torn and mangled. With quick lightnings, they are dashed to death. He fills the air and water with the invisible enemies of life, the messengers of pain, and watches the puppets as they breathe and drink. He creates cancers to feed upon their flesh, their quivering